2015, the news was abuzz with articles of an AI system that had learned to play arcade.
And much to our surprise, what happened was that the machine discovered for itself that optimal strategy was to dig a tunnel around the side of the wall and send the ball around the back, which is something even the programmers and research scientists working on this project didn't know how to do. We only told it to get the highest score it could.
With DQN, DeepMind had revolutionized reinforcement learning. It was the first algorithm that could play across a variety of complex environments while using only images of the screen as input. DQN laid the foundations for the field now known as DeepRL. Let's spend the next few minutes building an intuition for DQN. Are you familiar with Garfield? If not, here's what you need to know. He's an orange tabby. His human subject's name is John. He shares the house with a dog named Odie, who he finds annoying and moronic. He hates Mondays, he hates exercise, but loves lasagna. Would do anything
Sasha.
For it.
Hey Sasha, weren't we supposed to be talking about DQN? What has Garfield got to do with it?
Yep. So, suppose you're tasked with helping Garfield to get to the lasagna that John just baked.
Garfield, come and get it!
He needs to navigate the environment while avoiding Odie and steering clear of any furniture that may lay along his path. Given the small 3x3 grid, you could easily traverse the environment multiple times to build a mental map of the world. You could then store your insights by creating a lookup table that tells you the best action to perform in any cell of the grid. This approach, known as queue learning, was extremely popular pre-2015. But what happens if you have to learn to traverse this 1000x1000 grid? Or worse yet, an environment that gives you state information as continuous values. A lookup table would quickly get out of hand here. So, how does DQN handle this? Yes, you guessed it. We use neural networks to track this information.
But we don't have a labeled dataset here. But how do we know which is the correct action to be performed?
Good question. An RL agent learns by trial and error. Data is thus generated by having Garfield move around the environment and interact with it. Every step that Garfield takes in the environment generates a four-tuple called an experience. It tells us the current state of the agent, the action that it performed, the new state that it has landed in as a result, and the reward obtained by performing said action. In DQN, we built our dataset by storing these experiences in a replay memory.
Replay memory?
Okay. Have you been in a situation where long after it is over, your brain replays the events that transpired, causing you to think how things might have played out differently?
Sure. Constantly.
Well, a replay memory is a less sophisticated version of this for an RL agent. It stores the last N interactions that the agent had with its environment, causing the agent to see these multiple times and forcing it to learn from its past experiences.
So I'm guessing the state information acts as the input to the network and the action to perform is the desired output. But aren't we still missing the labels?
Right, that. We need to take a bit of a detour first. We know that moving Garfield to the right would get him to the lasagna faster, thereby making him happier than if we were to move him to the left cell. In DQN, we encode this information via state action value function, also known as Q values. Q values are a numerical indicator telling you how useful it is to perform a certain action in the given state in moving you towards your goal. More formally, it is the expected discounted return of performing action A in state S. In other words, if we were to follow the current policy, the Q value tells us what is the total discounted reward we might expect in the future if we perform action A right now. Now look closely at the formula here. Do you notice something about it? No? Okay. How about now?
Yes. The term can be written as another Q value?
Exactly. The Q value of the current state in action depend on the Q value of the next state in action, which in turn would depend on the next state in action, and so on. This recursive property will help us define the labels to learn on. In DQN, the Q value is estimated via the neural network. So, instead of directly telling us which action to perform, the neural network gives us an estimate of the Q values of each of the possible actions. The agent then acts by selecting the action with the highest Q value. Thus, the previous equation can be updated as such to take into account the neural network. Here, the right side of this equation is now your target Y and the left side your predicted Y. The network learns by computing the mean squared error between these two. You might have noticed something peculiar about this setup. Unlike supervised learning, where the targets represent the ground truth, in reinforcement learning, the targets are themselves just an estimate. This technique of using an estimate to update another estimate is known as bootstrapping.
I think I get it now, but when I Google DQN, I get two results, two papers. Why is it?
Good question. DQN was first introduced by DeepMind in late 2013. But the bootstrapping setup that we just discussed led to some instability issues. I mean, think about it. You have a network that is updated by computing the error between the predicted Q and the target Q. But both these values are estimated using the same network. Which means, after the update, the target Q value on the very same state would be completely different. This led to the predicted Q and the target Q constantly having to play catch up with each other. To circumvent this, when DeepMind published their paper in Nature in 2015, they introduced a second network called the target network. The target network is an exact replica of the already existing online network with one key difference. The target network never undergoes gradient updates. Introducing a second network meant that the predicted Q and the target Q values could now be computed via separate networks, thereby keeping the target Q values relatively constant.
Awesome. So is that it? Is this how DQN works?
Yep, pretty much. One last teeny tiny thing though. Remember previously we said that the agent acts by picking the action with the highest Q value. Well, this is the approach used during testing. During training, we need our agent to explore the environment, to see how it is laid out, to ensure that it finds the best possible route to the goal. DQN handles this by using something called an epsilon greedy policy. That means, based on a certain criteria, the agent decides whether to act randomly or to perform the action suggested by the network. But we won't get into the details of that here.
Oh my god, my brain could not have absorbed any more.
Right, so let's summarize. Data is collected by the agent interacting with the environment and stored in the replay buffer. The neural network accepts the current state as input and computes Q values for each of the potential states as output. The target in the setup is also an estimate, which could lead to instability during learning. This is resolved by introducing a second network whose sole purpose is to compute target values. And there we have it, folks, the DQN algorithm. So what task do you plan to solve with DQN? Let me know in the comments below. Oh, and one more thing, if you'd like to read further, I've written an entire series on this topic and I'll link it in the description below. Thank you for sticking around till the end. Hope this helped build some intuition. In the next video, we'll try to get a more concrete understanding of the topic by unpacking the algorithm presented in the Nature paper. See ya, have a lovely day.